Hi, Jeff here with Sarracenia Northwest, and I wanted to talk about today a topic that comes up very often when people come out to our nursery during open houses to visit, and they see many of our display plants. Because on the display plants, you're very likely to see some kind of a top dressing on top of the peat soil in there. We often get asked, you know, why is it there? Is that safe for the plants? You know, where do you find this kind of stuff? So those are the kinds of issues we wanted to go ahead and talk about today during this video. So first off, just an example of one of those plants. I have right over here one of our big Sarracenia hybrids, and this is one that we have top dressed with some rainbow rock pea gravel. And the rainbow rock is very commonly found in a lot of garden centers, very easy to find, it's inexpensive, and it's a lot of rocks that are well rounded like this, they're taken out of the bottoms of rivers, and so these have been in water a very long time. And that actually has an advantage I'll talk about in just a moment. But what this pea gravel is doing in the case of this particular pot is adding just some decorative backdrop to the plant itself, and it actually really helps with splash erosion in rain, especially when a plant has been newly potted up. So it serves both of those purposes for us when we do that. So let me talk about some of the other materials here and some of the advantages and disadvantages of using each. So since I was talking about rainbow rock pea gravel, that's some of this right here that I've got. And the rainbow rock, like I said, very decorative, easy to find, inexpensive, all of those things. They usually sell it in bags at landscape supply centers. The nice thing about any of the water washed gravel like this, both the rainbow rock pea gravel, and you can also get just kind of a standard pea gravel, which has some other type of rock here. Often it's basalt. Because these are harvested out of rivers, they're not going to leach anything into the soil, so they're very safe that way. There's also another advantage to using a rock top dressing on them, and that's if you're in a cooler climate like ours, or perhaps, you know, someplace in the northern U.S. or southern Canada. This can add a little extra heat to your pots as well for plants that really like that. Venus flytraps are a prime example that really appreciate the extra heat. Now, that turns into a disadvantage, however, if you're in a really hot climate, like maybe the southeastern U.S., Southern California, desert southwest, because what can happen then is the rocks can get so hot that they can actually burn the stems of the plants as well. So it's one of those things where it has to be a little bit of a judgment call. You know, I would say if you're in, again, Pacific Northwest, northern parts of the country, northeast, this kind of top dressing is going to be just great. Maybe in a much hotter climate where you have much hotter summers, maybe not. Now, also like the other rainbow rock, is just some big gravel pieces here. This is actually the same substance, it's just larger than the other rainbow rock we were looking at. This can make just sort of a fun backdrop for larger planters. It's not going to serve the same function as the small stuff for erosion control, but can be very attractive with the plant. Again, you know, just kind of use some common sense when using stuff like this. Where you place it among there, but it's going to be mostly for decorative purposes when you use this. Sands can also make a really nice top dressing. Now, the most common one and easiest to use is this stuff that I've got right here, which is a type of silica sand. Silica is, it's just pure silicon dioxide, and this is usually sold in the form of like commercial grade sand that you might find at one of the big box hardware stores. Or this particular batch I have here is actually pool filter sand, and many hardware stores carry this in 50 or 100 pound sacks. What's really nice about silica sand is it also doesn't add anything to the soil. It sometimes is found in native carnivorous plant habitats as well, particularly like in the Carolinas in that area. And so this is also very similar to what some plants would be in along with peat in their native habitats. This other sand that I've got here, this is another one that we picked up, and there wasn't a whole lot of information with this one at first. But it turns out this is more of sand that may have like some marble or limestone in it. It probably came from a different place. This sand we discovered was not real appropriate to use, and the reason is because it actually does turn the pH of the soil more alkaline. So if you're unsure about what, you know, with sand or even some gravel that you want to use on top of a pot, you may want to actually test the pH of that. And there's a super easy way to do that. You can go to a hardware store. If you already have fish, you may have some of this stuff already, but just get a little simple pH indicator test kit. I've got a little tiny vial here, but you could use something larger. Put some of the sand or whatever rock you're using in there with it. Go ahead and use some distilled water so that your tap water is not adding anything to the mix as well. Let it sit for about 24 hours and then add your pH test drops and see what color they turn. And most of them have a little card or label that goes with it to show you whether it's acid or alkaline. If the pH is 7 or below, you're just fine. If it goes above 7, probably best not use that material for a top dressing on your plants. Now, all the top dressings I just talked about are ones that are for or inorganic stuff or rock materials on there. The sand that I mentioned can really be just a very attractive dressing for many plants. Not quite as good for the splash erosion control, but it just depends on how heavy rainfall is in your particular area. Now I want to talk about some of the organic top dressings that you can use also. So what I have here is a couple different types of sphagnum moss. I have some long fiber sphagnum, and this is the same media that we use to make our tropical mix with. We add perlite to this. You can also find this in a lot of garden centers that carry orchid supplies. This happens to be New Zealand sphagnum moss. The Chilean is a really good variety as well, and you may see some domestic sphagnum moss that's often a lot darker, not quite as attractive sometimes, but it'll work if you want to use that. And if you have access to it, live sphagnum moss can make a fantastic top dressing and is actually what's likely to be growing next to plants in many of their native habitats where they come from in bogs. Sometimes you can also find live sphagnum moss, small quantities of it for sale on places like eBay. A few of the carnivorous plant nurseries carry it. We don't currently. That may change in the future, but for right now you would probably have to find this in a different location. What I want to show you though is how to use some of the sphagnum moss to top dress, and some advantages to using sphagnum on top of the pot is it has excellent erosion control. Rain just tends to go right through it and it doesn't get down to the soil level at all, as where sometimes with the gravel, if your layer's not thick enough, it can the peat can try and creep its way up. But with the sphagnum, you don't tend to get that happening quite as much. And it actually will make a really nice backdrop for other kinds of plants if you want some little sundews or something growing with your pot or a larger planter as well. So here I have a Sarracenia alata, one of our red hood types here. So I want to go ahead and put some of the sphagnum on top of this and show you what that would look like. I like to use gloves when doing this. Alrighty, so sphagnum is usually sold dry in like little packages or bales, and so you'll want to hydrate it really well before you use this stuff. And of course, use low mineral water when you're doing this, just like you would for watering your plants. So I'm going to take some, I'm going to squeeze the water out of it, and then I'm just going to start taking some, and I just sort of take little tufts of it and begin putting it around the tops of the pots. You may find like little sticks and things in there, just get rid of that stuff. If you've got really, really long strands of the sphagnum, feel free to get a pair of scissors and cut it too if it's a little bit hard to handle. So once you have the moss all just kind of stuffed in there, you're complete and it's ready to go, and that'll protect it from some heavy rains and also allow a nice little backdrop for things like small sundews and Sarracenia seedlings to go ahead and get established, especially if you have a larger planter. Now, some of the disadvantages of using the long fiber sphagnum moss can be that during hotter weather, it also can have a tendency to dry out, especially if you have it in larger planters. And if you happen to have access to live sphagnum, that's especially true for that, and sometimes it'll end up dying. Like we've tried doing live sphagnum on our bathtub gardens a few times, and it's just too hard to keep it wet enough on those for it to survive. But otherwise, you know, there's just different options. You just may have to figure out what works for you. Thanks for watching.